Thank you for being here. Thank you, Yari, for being here also and for having your work up in the gallery. As I mentioned to you, every morning when I come in, I walk into that room and it is a tour de force, visually, emotionally, and I really, really enjoy this work. So I'm so glad that we're able to talk about it. For those of you who do not know much about Yari, let me give you a little, very brief background. Yari was born in 1962, a year before me, in Iran. Grew up in Tehran. And then he moved to the United States at the age of 16. I'm going to ask you why at some point and how. But he pursued his studies in art first at the University of Nevada, Reno, and then at the San Francisco Art Institute, where he received his MFA in 1995. He has exhibited extensively in the United States and internationally, and he's the recipient of the Sierra Arts Endowment Grant, the Craig Shepherd Memorial Grant, and Sierra Nevada Arts Foundation Grant. His artwork can be found in private and institutional collections around the world. And so welcome, Yari.
Thank you so much.
The thing that I want to start with that we've discussed a bit, but it's the mysterious and the mystical. You focus on mystery and mysticism. Tell us a little bit about that. Obviously it comes out in the art. How does mysticism inform not just your work but your life? How does this all weave together?
Well, mysticism has always held a very special place for me. It's basically, or spirituality, if you call it that, which to me has always been basically nothing more than a poetic reading of the existence, really, of existence. And my work actually, I should go back a bit, started figuratively. And there were figures, and it was more surrealistic. And gradually, the figures started to fade away, kind of dissolve into the background more and more. And the last pieces before my work became fully abstract, there were figures where they were masked and cut very precisely, but like wet medium was put in and dried pigment powder was sprinkled on them. So there were silhouettes, but they were very luminous and full of color. And really vibrating. And gradually as I was doing that, I realized that what was happening in the background was drawing me in. And I found it more interesting than what was going on with the figures. So the figures began to disappear. And the background became the figure, really, the main point. And it's interesting because early on when I was younger, when I was working, my influences were Dali, Kiriko, as I guess it's a surrealist, but gradually, I mean, I was always touched by the work of Rothko and especially Antoni Tapies, but these, I realized that they were kind of dormant influences, and they began to come forward at that time, and since then it has become this journey of discovery, just kind of letting these textures and colors come together and to see where they go. And I've realized that what is important for me in these is a sense of synergy. Because first thing I do when I go to the studio, I try to be as clear as possible with a very much of a Zen mind, you know, pull back as much as possible, break the white of the canvas, first of all. And then the next thing you do is a response to that. And the next thing is a response to those two things. I keep going on. It stays kind of like a game, like an interplay between these shapes and forms and colors. And after a while, a sense of synergy becomes to come forward. And that's what I work towards. And that's where the mystery is for me. at the beginning when I started working this way, allowing it to happen like that, I was worried that the work would be all over the place, basically, because I had no framework for it, just letting it happen completely. But after a while, I realized that there is a visual language developing, that there's a thread going through these, and they know what they're doing. So I became more and more open to what they're doing and to pulling away from that. And that's where other influences came in. Music has always been a major influence in my life. Unfortunately, I never learned an instrument, but I always played around with music. I sang in choirs for many years. And one of my role models was really Keith Jarrett, his improvisations. You know, basically, that's how I approach the work. You are responsible in your conscious way for showing up in the studio, sharpening your skills, doing the work, and then for the other part, for the unconscious or the subconscious part, you let it happen, you move out of the way as much as possible. This is how I've been working for the past 30, 35 years now. And I'm always amazed at what comes up next. I'm always very curious what will happen next. And like I said, they always fall within this visual language, you know. Does that help?
Yeah, I find it interesting that you speak of the paintings as animated, that you call them they, and they do this, and they find this, or they strive towards that. And I did notice, I mean, we talked a bit about the music, but clearly in some of the titles is the music. And since you mentioned that, one of our patrons here at Radian, he pointed out that the piece downstairs, I said, oh, this is, you know, for Gustav Mahler. And he says, it looks like Mahler.
Very happy to hear
that. Yeah, but then I thought to myself, how do you make a piece of art look like a piece of music? Because indeed, when I played Mahler and sat and looked at that piece, it looks like Mahler. But so when you're interpreting, you're hearing this music, whether it's Jarrett or Mahler, and you're putting it through the filter of a visual lens that is learned. You mentioned Rothko. I also see Turner in these
major influence.
I see Barnett Newman. I see the 19th century abstract landscape artists like Caspar David Friedrich. So I see sort of these ethereal landscapes, but you're making a landscape look like music. Tell us a bit about, is there a thought process, or is it like Jarrett would compose and play, where it just flows and you know when it's right?
It's the latter. Letting it happen. And in a way, actually, it's interesting you said that, because I always call myself, not always, but I call myself really a composer, really, who works with paint and texture, because the elements of music and abstract paintings are very much the same. I'm not talking about pictorializing music. I'm talking about going back to where music comes from, to the beginning of the source, really, to the source where music comes from. I have a series, one of which is here, the Cantata, which is a tribute to Bach, and somebody asked me in an interview, well, where is Bach in these? I said, Bach isn't here. It's the impetus for the series, kind of an internalized response to that. And what happens from there, it's again, has to do with the painting itself, where it wants to go. But it seems like it does carry that original impetus in it somehow, like the Mahler painting you just said. Mahler, I've always loved Mahler. My main love is Beethoven. Mahler I've always loved. And I think actually the movie Maestro recently kind of rekindled some of that energy. And especially that the end of the Resurrection Symphony, which was in that, and it brought that forward. Because this painting was done after that, after I saw that movie. But I guess, like I said, you know, that influence was sitting there, was waiting to come out. I have a series of basically tributes and homages to different people who have influenced me in different ways, from authors like John Berger, whom I just adore, to Beethoven and Mahler and beyond, Bruckner, etc. And these pieces began to happen, and originally I realized there was enough of them to form a coherent group as a series, and so now there's a series of tributes that goes on, and every once in a while something comes up. There are pieces for Keith Jarrett as well, whom I am very much indebted to in opening my eyes. And this is interesting. The friend who introduced me to Keith Jarrett's music, I was listening at that time to Paul Winston. Was it Paul Winston?
The new age,
and he introduced me to the Coley concert of Keith Jarrett, and he said, "This is like Winston with teeth," and that actually opened up a whole new path in my life, you know, and a love affair with his music and his way of creating that has been now very much, I think, intertwined with the way I create work.
What results here, I mean, apart from the one that to me, you know, captures Mahler beautifully, because it actually looks, it has visual aspects of a score, even, you know, the lines, the rivulets running up and down.
Interesting.
But it's also very much like many of these are like Sugimoto seascapes, you know, the photographer Sugimoto, and they end up being. I can see that they are about something, but they end up being places. They end up being landscapes or seascapes. They're places. And are they, do you realize when you're making them that you are making places that people go to, that visually people will see as a place, a moonscape, a landscape, you know, a storm in the sky?
Not necessarily when I'm making them, but I know they're internal landscapes.
Mm-hmm.
They are, in a way, to me, they're landscapes that are very familiar, places we've been internally. And when a piece is successful, I think it's because that it kind of makes that resonance with the viewer, that you feel something familiar about that. You know this place. You've been there before, but it's an internal place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not when I'm working. When I'm working, like I said, I try to be as free as any kind of influence as possible, at least to my conscious self, and just let it happen.
Mm-hmm.
See, one thing that actually came out of necessity that helped that process is that since I work in oils, and I work in many layers, I have to wait for layers to dry. And I'm not going to just sit around and wait for 2 weeks for something to dry. So I work on many pieces at the same time. Occasionally, sometimes of different sizes, you know, not all large. I work on sometimes 40 pieces at the same time. It doesn't mean that I'm working on all 40 every day. But I'm working on something and it's drying, or I get stuck in it. And then I go and work on something else. And meanwhile, in the back of my mind, that other piece is kind of going on. It's being resolved. And then I go back to that, and then I learn something from this one that I go and put on this one, and then it goes back and forth. One thing that helped me with was to get more involved with the process of creating. So I'm not involved with the painting. I'm involved with the process of painting. It doesn't matter what I'm working on, because there are always pieces in the process of being finished, always ones that I'm middle of, always ones that are beginning. I could, you know, some piece might finish in 2 weeks or 2 days, another one could take 2 years.
Hmm.
Doesn't matter, because there's always something else I'm working on. As long as the work goes on and gets to a point where it cuts off its umbilical cord from me and see it, you know, it becomes its own entity. It came through me, but now it's free from me.
Mm-hmm.
Like children, you know, they go on and they live their own lives, you know, sometimes they might call or send a postcard, but they're no longer living at home, so to speak.
Yeah, sticking with the idea of landscape, you've described these as a psychic geology.
Internal landscape, psychic.
And I think, you know, I feel like I've been some of these places, usually in dreams. Right, Do you think that, tell me about the connection to the subconscious and the unconscious that you try to bring forth into this work, into these psychic geologies that you're building.
Well, the conscious part is a discipline, and knowing your trade and knowing your craft and doing what's needed to do, showing up in the studio every day. And the rest, like I said, is just completely pulling yourself aside, out of the way, and let it happen. Sometimes you work on something for a while and it's not going anywhere. You set it aside, you work on other things, you go back to it 6 months later, you just do this thing on it, and the whole thing falls into place. It just becomes full of life. And you could not have gotten there without those other 6 months of getting busy with other things. Mm-hmm. Because that needed to actually ripen somewhere in there, in here. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know how the mystery works, and I don't think it's for us to know. I try to just let it happen, because I think as soon as you start figuring out a mystery, it's like taking a trunk instead of a tree. It's no longer alive. It becomes a subject of analysis. And that's a whole different thing, which works in other contexts, but not in my context.
And the exploration that goes into these, when did this start? Did you always have this feeling that you needed to go deeper to find these psychic geologies to create these otherworldly landscapes? When did you realize that this was where you wanted to go? You know, again, right. Not just, I mean, no one thinks of themselves when they're 5 years old, I'm going to be a painter. Mm-hmm. Or they might, but I... But in general, this must have built out of something. Was it out of experience? Was it out of challenges? Where did this sensibility, where did it come from?
Well, there's no clear demarcation line, but even as a kid, I was very creative. I always was interested in creative things. Mm-hmm. And early on, when I was an adolescent, I was interested in poetry a lot more, Persian modern poetry especially. Mm-hmm. And then when I was introduced to the visual arts and I started taking drawing classes, that took me in a completely different direction. But I was always interested in making things, building things, putting things together. And I was a daydreamer. I was a dreamer to begin with. And I always had a poetic vein, mm-hmm. I guess. And... it's interesting because, like I said, my early work was figurative. And that's the time where you're trying to figure out when you're younger who you're painting for. It's your parents, your teachers, the weight of history on your shoulder, the painters who came before you. And when I left school, usually I tell that to young people now too, it will take a year or two to rid yourself of what you learned, which is when the real learning begins. It doesn't mean that learning was useless. It is essential to get you to the point to push it aside. Mm-hmm. Without it, you wouldn't get there. So I'm very much for a classical training in art. You have to know what you are pushing aside. And then, like I said, you know, when the backgrounds became more interesting for me than what was going on in the foreground, I dove in. I think it was about a year and a half when I was just working in my studio, not showing my work to anyone. I was working on maybe 20 pieces and they were not really going anywhere. But after about a year and a half, one by one, they started falling into place. And I realized that they were trying to tell me something and I need to listen more. And I started since then to listen more and more. And that's the beginning of this journey.
So this point when here you are, you're a young man, you're interested in poetry, you're a dreamer, as you say. What did that mean for you in Iran at the time? What were the expectations of you? Was it okay to be a dreamer? Was it okay to want to be a poet?
It was interesting because my father himself was a very learned man. He was very artistic. did some paintings, which I didn't know about until after he passed away, found those paintings. Wrote poetry, and he was friends with most of the literary luminaries of the day. But he was very insistent that I do not follow an artistic path because, you know, parents usually worry about their children and making a living. So the compromise was, okay, well, you're artistically talented, well, maybe you can go into architecture. And I took that on for a while. And when I came here, I studied architecture for a short time. But it was after my father passed away over there that I got the courage to find, no, this is not what I want to do. I want to study art. Mm-hmm. And I did that full time then.
So you came here in the early 80s?
No, before that, 1978.
78, okay.
4 months before the revolution.
Okay. And so you came here not knowing that there would be a revolution?
Well, we had an inkling. Things were already in upheaval. And mm-hmm. when I left, there was already martial law. There were tanks on the street. Mm-hmm. And actually, my older brother was here studying. He came here when he was 18. We had a very good relationship with the U.S. at that time. A lot of young Iranians came here, studied, went back. And so the idea was to learn a new language, become acquainted with a new culture, and go back, and hopefully enrich the life of, you know, your own country. But I left when I was 16 because my father saw what was coming, and he was trying to get me out of harm's way. And that's why he kind of expedited sending me abroad. Usually, like I said, you wait until you get your high school diploma and then. But I was 16 years old, and so I had still 2 years of high school in front of me here. First year, which was in Texas, very small town, very interesting memories from there. And then Reno. Oh, it was Lorena, Texas. Official sign said population 500. It was very interesting experience.
Did the rest of your family follow here, or did they remain in Iran?
That's a kind of a broken story, too, because, like I said, my older brother was already here. He was studying in Nevada, in Reno. My parents, at that time, you had to get exit permits to leave the country, and then they had to apply for their green card through my uncle, who had lived here for 6 years already. They got their interview at the American Embassy, and it was for the day that it was taken over. So everything was pushed back, all the files were destroyed, and by the time we got that back on track, my father had passed away. So my mom and my younger brother came at that time. But so the last 4 years of his life, I did not see. Mm.
But he gave you this, essentially. He saw, as you say, he foresaw the...
Not directly, but indirectly. Mm-hmm. He was basically, as you know, a lot of friends do what I say, not what I do.
Right.
But it was like, oh, but you've done this all your life. You can't tell me that. But you can't say that to them, of course.
Right. Specifically with to some of the titles, tell us about the Conference of the Birds. I found that to be a fantastic story. It's a Sufi poem. From the 15th century? 13th century.
Right.
And it's a remarkable story. And it's informed your work. And I believe Conference of the Birds 66 and 71 that we have here, you're just doing another one in the sequence each time.
Yes, I mean, that series started like 30 years ago, I think, and it's still ongoing.
Amazing.
It was a story of, in a time of chaos, basically, birds got together to look for their king, which was, of the phoenix, and they go on this journey, thousands of birds, to look for their king to bring peace and prosperity to the land. And along the trip, many of them drop out for different reasons. That's the whole book is about that, different... it's all very allegorical, of course. Mm-hmm. At the end, very tired, 30 of them get to the mountain and they're looking for the king and for the Simur, the phoenix. They can't find them. There's a play on words in Persian. Simur is the name of phoenix, but it actually also could be read as two words, Simur, 30 birds. So 30 birds are the ones who finish the trip, this journey. And turn around, they find out that they themselves are that phoenix. Now, we have read that, you know, maybe a shortened version of that in high school, but it was years later through the work of Peter Brook that I recently rediscovered it. Mm-hmm. And it came back, and that's when the series started.
Mm-hmm. And so, to me, and again, everybody has their own interpretation, these are the places that the birds saw, places that they went, the places they were tested. Is that
yes and no.
A good interpretation?
It was completely, it's like putting myself in that space, in that atmosphere, mm-hmm. and letting it happen. Could be that as well, but that wasn't necessarily the intention.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah, because I see these landscapes or seascapes or cloudscapes, and I think of them as places, and so I immediately sort of said, okay, well, this must have been one of the stops along the way.
Well, I tell you, I've seen other treatments of the story. It's a very gripping story, so it's been dealt with different artists by different artists over time. I've seen versions where you basically have like bird's view of landscape.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not my thing.
No, so it's like a little too CNC, isn't
right.
it? Yeah. And so, but so Sufism, mysticism, that comes back around again,
right.
and Persian lore. It's interesting how you've carried that. I mean, you carried that forward in such a complete way. We most of us in this country come from someplace else. We have roots in other countries and or in San Francisco we often have roots in other cities or other parts of the country. We came here to discover something new. But how important do you think it is to carry with you these things throughout your life that may have been for you, it was the first 20 years approximately, and there have been now 40 more of those years, and how have you carried it forward? How have you put some of it back behind you? What does it continue to mean for you? The influences that are this mysticism, that are this lore and these legends.
Well, very much so. I've basically I have to come to terms with the fact that I am I live in between cultures. You know, I have my roots there, but then I have had all my adult experiences here. My adult life has been here, with a brief sojourn in Germany, as I said, 5 years there. And so, basically, I don't join any club which would have me as a member, so I'm not a Sufi, basically.
Mm-hmm.
But what interests me is the mystical approach in different cultures and what overlaps in these different cultures, be it Native American spiritualism, mysticism, Christian mysticism, Islamic mysticism, or Jewish, or Zen, Taoism, Hinduism. I don't believe in any of them. What draws me in is where they overlap in terms of mysticism and the poetic outlook on existence.
Mm-hmm.
So, not any one of these pulls me in completely, because a lot of it is basically native accents, be it from the east or from the west, has to do with the dominant culture there. So, the mysticism that draws me in, like I said, is not I can't really say the idea of mysticism, but the overlapping of these different traditions. So, being away from the culture in which I was born affords me some perspective to look at it with some clarity, I would think. And also would allow me to pick things from the new culture I live in a little more carefully, put them together in a way that makes sense to me.
So, interesting to me, this is what goes in to the work. This is what goes into the work. One of the first times I saw your work, it was shown to me by Ali Saif.
Yes.
And then, of course, I came over to Alameda to see a show that you had done. Was what you call, or what you say, you're trying to conjure Lux Eterna, this light inner space. Light. And that's exactly what I saw, was that these pieces actually appear to have light within them that shines out. Talk a little bit about Lux Eterna and how you conjure it, both from a technical perspective, but more so as you're working through it, how do you know when you've achieved Lux Eterna?
How I achieve it, I'm not sure. That's part of that mystery. Mm-hmm. But it is what I search and what I look for in the piece, often, more often than not, it's there. But like I said, the way I work is a process of adding and subtracting, going back and forth until a sense of synergy comes into being. And from there, I'm in the dark, in a way, as to how it happens. Because I'm afraid if I figure it out, I may lose it. You know what I mean? So
you do conjure it, but you don't know exactly, you don't want to know how you conjure
exactly.
it.
Exactly, I don't want to know how it comes to being. Because you know, it has to do a lot with, again, with allowing things to happen, with peripheral vision. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that I heard many years ago and it affected me was by Alan Watts. And he talked about how at night when you look at a star, it diminishes. As soon as you look away from it, it brightens up again. He was talking about the importance of peripheral vision. So I try not to focus on something for too long. Same again with working on different pieces at the same time. Like I said, if I focus on something for too long, it gets stuck. And the way it frees itself is when I busy myself with other things. Because peripheral vision, peripheral mind, I'm still working on that, except not right in front of me, mm-hmm. you know. And what will happen with the peripheral vision will never happen, at least for me, with just straight ahead confrontation with the piece. Mm-hmm. You know? So in that way, especially after years of seeing it, that it works, it's like it's not my place to figure out how it works. Because, mm-hmm. like I said, you know, if I figure it out, it may no longer do its thing.
That's right. The puzzle's been solved, right?
Exactly.
And then that's no fun. I mean, it's fun for a second, and then you got to put the pieces back in the box.
Over the years, it has given me, they have given me trust that they know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And we were talking earlier about possibly, like, I don't believe in artist box anymore. Mm-hmm. Because I see the larger curve, like putting myself, the larger arc, pulling back more to see it, like when you get stuck on something, it's still being worked on. You have to allow that to happen. You can go and work on something else and let this happen. And then it happens. You know, if you're working in the studio and everything is going great, well, that's wonderful. If not, it's because you are dealing with something, you're working on something. It could be you can get through it the next day, next month, or 6 months from now. But you will get through it, and you won't, there are no shortcuts. You have to go through these painful paths sometimes to get there. But if you trust it, you always get there. They have shown me that they do that. You know, in my youth, I might have, you know, thrown away a painting or something. I never do that now because it will work. If not now, it will in 5 years.
With wisdom, with age comes wisdom, right?
One hopes.
Yes. Any questions from those of you out there about Yari's work and his influences?
It's clear.
No, it's clear, but I see, like, for me, you're talking about landscapes, and what I see is like this piece of a landscape, because for me, the visual landscape is not. Mm-hmm. Why? how or what makes you decide which part of the landscape you're capturing? You want to turn to tell you? Because, I mean, a landscape is visual, it's the entire 270 degrees that you're able to see. And the format that you use, for me, it's kind of encapsulating this piece of the landscape.
Well, whatever the piece is, it has to become a self-sufficient entity.
Yeah.
So, whichever part you're focusing on has to have a protagonist, so to speak, mm-hmm. and a supporting cast. So basically, there's one area that pulls you in as the main area or the main point, and there are other things in support of that. Or if they're opposing it, the whole thing is working in a harmonious way. So for that, then that's the end thing for me. You know, it doesn't matter if it's you know, propped this way or that way, as long as it works together at the end.
So, but you're containing it. I mean, you're on purpose containing it in the format that you're using. That
I'm not containing it on purpose. If I'm containing it, I'm containing it. But I'm not containing it on purpose. So it wants to come across that way. But as long as it works, if it comes across as a kind of an idea of a landscape that's falling short, then the piece is not successful.
Mm.
You know. Now, that could have to do with the cropping, like you said, or could do with other elements. But however it is focused on, or zoomed in, or cropped, it has to work as a full and single entity for me to be successful. Thank you.
Anything else?
I really like your work.
Thank you.
Thanks for sharing the story, too. It's great to hear the story.
Thank you so much.
And the texture, to me, is really compelling. Can you share a little bit more about the texture in your work?
Well, the texture, you said there are a lot of layers, and I use a lot of, like, either turpentine, paint thinner, or different kind of mediums to thin the paint or to eat the paint away, sometimes wipe it off, and, of course, you know, you got the detritus remaining from the last layer, and then going over it again, going back and forth. And when you do that, you start getting this kind of shimmering effect from when you have like 80 layers on the painting and they're not all opaque, and something begins to happen, you know. So there's a lot of working with different mediums. I don't know if you call oil mediums, media, plural, I'm not sure. But after a while, you learn how each of them behaves. And I use them sometimes with each other, sometimes against each other. I know this one eats the paint in a certain way. I know this one makes it dry faster. This one takes longer. So kind of letting it work together in some way. After a while, you begin to understand their language. So there's a lot of going back and forth in that way until that shift happens. That synergy I call the breath of life. You know, it's like, it gives you goosebumps, it gives me goosebumps. It has to give me goosebumps before I can give anyone else any kind of bump. So yeah, just going back and forth, glazing, scraping, all kinds of things. Another thing is that for years now, I rarely use traditional painting material. I rarely use regular brushes. I still do, but often I use whatever's, you know, is within reach. Spatulas. A little piece of plastic. Somehow I push myself not to use traditional tools for some reason, but it's been working. So.
Yeah, you write again that your work is very technique oriented or technique dependent. There really is no other way from your perspective as an artist to achieve what you're envisioning without this really intensive, layered, organic technique. This is part and parcel. Right.
And part is, for example, you know, at some point I'm working and there are two wet paintings and I take them, stick them together and pull them apart, and like one of them just starts working. But then I can't go, okay, this is a technique I'll use. Next time I go into the studio, I'll take two wet paintings. No. it just has to happen at the right moment, and it needed that, and it benefited from that, at least one of them, sometimes both of them take off. But that's the thing, you know, you come across that, so, okay, this is something that can be in my toolbox, but I cannot be using it in a conscious way, because then it becomes contrite.
So you've got your, that's your Keith Jarrett.
Yes.
But then your Gustav Mahler or your Bach or your Mozart, very controlling, very, very much, I mean, clearly there are things that break out of their compositions that are startling and new.
Still not that controlling. Yeah. Still, I mean, at some point you got to, the piece has to land. You know, at some point you got to go, okay, now I got to bring it down. You can't just go on experimenting on a piece forever, ever end.
Right. There has to be a point at which the goosebumps occur and
exactly.
And the light shines from within, and it becomes its own thing.
I think of what Gerhard Richter said when asked about when is a painting finished. It's like when anything else I can do to it would be superfluous. I'm paraphrasing, but yeah. Basically it's like it doesn't need anything else.
Yeah, very good. Thank you very much, Yari.
Thank you.
Wonderful conversation to delve deeper, and thank all of you for
so
being
much.
Here. This was a really lovely conversation.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it.
Thanks, Yari.